So I guess it's time. Welcome everyone. My name is Benjamin Teke. In this talk, I will be presenting you the Apache Hadoop YARN fs2cs tool. It is a CLI helper tool to help convert fast scheduler settings to capacity scheduler settings. First of all, let me introduce myself. My name is Benjamin Teke. I joined CloudEra's YARN Budapest team early this year. I'm currently working on diagnostics collector to help diagnose and fix YARN's basic scheduler related problems, application crashes, etc. And I also contributed to queue mapping engine, fs2cs, and other various smaller improvements. I recently started to specialize in YARN scheduling. Before CloudEra, I worked in the telecom industry. I mostly developed the big data network analytics tool and mainly used Kafka and HBase with it. This presentation will consist of four parts. The first one is a quick overview about YARN. The second is the overview of schedulers. The third one will be about the tool in question, the Hadoop fs2cs tool. And the fourth one will be a short demo about the tool. How does it work? What does it do? So what is YARN? YARN stands for yet another resource negotiator. The YARN cluster has basically two types of hosts, the resource manager and the node manager. The resource manager is the master daemon that communicates with clients, tracks resources on the cluster, and orchestrates work by assigning tasks to the node managers. Node managers, on the other hand, are worker daemons that launch and track up processes spawned on worker hosts. For each running application, there is an application master, which helps to coordinate tasks on the YARN cluster. Its responsibilities are job lifecycle management and resource need fulfillment. A container is a concept of YARN. It is basically a request to hold resources on a cluster. So how does this look like in the practice? When the client starts an application, it will begin to talk to the resource manager. The resource manager makes a single container request on behalf of that application. This will be the application master's container. The application master will start running in that container, and it will submit subsequent requests, container requests to the resource manager. These containers will be allocated to run tasks for that application. Once all tasks are finished, the application manager will be shut down, it exits, and the last container will be deallocated from the cluster. Let's move on to the scheduling part. As I've mentioned, the resource manager is responsible for tracking and assigning resources on a cluster, and scheduler is a very important part of the resource manager, which does this matching, honoring organizational policies. YARN has basically three different schedulers: FIFO, FAIR, and capacity scheduler. FIFO, as the name suggests, orders the jobs based on submission time. The first to arrive gets to be served the first, and when it finishes, the next one gets launched. This doesn't require any configuration. It is more like a POC, a proof of concept scheduler. As the talk is about migrating FAIR scheduler to capacity scheduler, I will give a more detailed overview on those two schedulers. Let's begin with FAIR scheduler. FAIR scheduling is a method of assigning resources to applications so that all applications are getting an equal share of resources over time. By default, FAIR scheduler bases scheduling fairness decisions on memory, but it can be configured to schedule with both memory and CPU, GPU, FPGA, or any other custom resource using the something called dominant resource fairness. The dominant resource fairness is basically a way to provide fairness decisions based on multidimensional resource vectors. FIFO and any other custom fairness scheduling policy class can be created to decide between these, make these fairness decisions. The basic idea is in FAIR scheduler that when there is a single app, it gets to use the entire cluster, and when new apps are submitted, they will get the resources that free up. In time, every app should get about the same amount of resources. This allows for quick and smaller tasks to finish in reasonable time without starving the long-lived tasks. First scheduler organizes apps in queues and shares resources fairly between these queues. By default, all apps share a single queue. It is called default. Within each queue, a scheduling policy is used to share the resources between the running apps. The default is memory-based file sharing, but those that I mentioned before can be also used here. Queues can be arranged into a hierarchy tree structure in order to divide the resources and share the cluster in specific proportions. All queues descend from the queue named root. Available resources are distributed among the children in fair scheduling fashion here as well, but there's a possibility to define weight and guaranteed minimum maximum resource limits. Weights are used to determine the amount of resources that a container, that a queue should get in relation to its siblings. If, for example, a queue called A has the weight of 2 and its only sibling B has 1, then in the long run, with constant load on both of the queues, A will get twice as many resources as B. An application can only be submitted to leaf queues. When there are multiple queues, policies can be configured that automatically place the submitted application to appropriate queues. These policies are called the placement rules. A placement can depend on the user or the group of the submitter and the requested queue passed on by the application. A policy contains a set of rules that are applied sequentially to classify an incoming application. Each rule either places an app into a queue or rejects it. When no matching queue is present and the automatic rule creation, queue creation is not possible, then the next rule will be evaluated. A rule can be specified, user, primary group, secondary group, existing queue, nested user queue, default, or reject. Specified means that the application requests a queue to be placed on, and this rule is present, it will be placed onto that queue. User and primary group means that the application will go to the leaf queue named by the user or the user's primary group under root. Secondary group existing queue rule will place the application on the first existing secondary group of the user. Just to clarify, primary group is mostly the first group of the user. Secondary group is all the other groups. Nested user queue will create a user under a specified parent other than the root. Default will define the default queue, and reject will reject the application if the placement if the application reaches that rule in the placement. Each rule can have a create attribute that is by default true, and if it is true, then if the queue doesn't exist and applies, it will be created automatically. Let's see an example for this. On the left, you can see the rule setup, and on the right, you can see the actual queue setup. In the first example, if the app specifies the root.developer queue, it will be placed to the developer queue because specified rule exists and it is the first one. If the app specifies no queue and only has one group called admin, then because primary groups, its primary group will be admin, and because primary group's create attribute is false, it will be placed to default because it doesn't. The secondary group existing queue doesn't apply to it because it has no secondary group, and default will be applied to it. If the app specifies no queue and has primary group developer, then because the primary group rule is here and then there is a developer queue, it will be placed to the developer queue. And if the app specified no queue has primary group admin, but has a secondary group called marketing, then it will be placed under the marketing in a queue called by the username. If the user is not Alice or Bob, then because the create flag here is true, it is the default, then a new user's queue will be created. So that's about fair scheduling. Let's talk about capacity scheduler. The main motivation behind capacity scheduler was to design a scheduler that allows multiple organizations in a company to share a single compute cluster instead of each of them using separate ones. This is beneficial because having separate clusters designed to support each of the organization's needs in peak or near peak conditions can lead to low overall average utilization. This was achieved by using queues like in Fair Scheduler and declaring capacity guarantees to each queue. Resources available in a cluster are shared among these queues based on these guarantees, and if configured, any queue can access the excess resources that are not being used by others. This proves the much needed elasticity in a cluster. Resources to be considered in the capacity calculation can be memory, or just like in the first scheduler case, a lot of different custom resources using dominant resource fairness. Let's see, let's take a look at the following queue setup. Just like in Fair Scheduler, all queues are children of root, and application can only be submitted to leaf queues. Capacity is assigned as a minimum and maximum percentage of the parent. So let's take a look at leaf low. Low has 20% of minimum capacity. That means that it will at least get, if needed, 20% of its parent preferences capacity, which means that it will get at least 20% of its parent, so roots, that means the entire cluster's capacity. On a level, every child's minimum resources should add up to 100%. For elasticity, also maximum capacity support can be also enabled. This means that any excess resources that are not being used by others can be used by these queues up to that point specified in the maximum capacity. If, for example, ad hoc uses 10% of root's capacity, workflow uses none, preference can only use 80% of the remaining 90% of the cluster's capacity. In addition to queue capacities, minimum user percentage and user limit factor can be configured to enable finer resource control. Minimum user percentage is a soft limit on the smallest amount of resources a single user should get. If it is 10%, the user should get at least 10% of the queue's minimum capacity. When the users are requesting less, more users can be placed on that queue. User limit factor, on the other hand, is a maximum limit. It is a multiple of the queue's minimum capacity, where one means that the user can use at most the queue's entire minimum capacity. 0.5 means half, and 3 means 3 times as much. Just like in Fair Scheduler, Capacity Scheduler has also a feature to automatically place the application into queues. This is called mapping rules. However, its approach is a bit different than in Fair Scheduler. The format is entirely different, but just like in Fair Scheduler, user, primary, and secondary responders are supported, and there is a possibility to use dynamically created queues. However, it lacks the specified rules equivalent, it doesn't have nested rules, and dynamic queue creation behaves a bit differently. In Capacity Scheduler, apparent queues can either be managed parents or non-managed parents. A managed parent can only have dynamically created queues, while non-managed parents can only have static queues defined in capacityscheduler.xml. This is different from Fair Scheduler, where every single rule can have a create attribute, and you can mix and match static and dynamically created rules, queues. Instead of going through every single feature that Capacity Scheduler supports, let me go through the ones that might lead to someone considering migrating to Capacity Scheduler from Fair Scheduler. Before YARN 5139 was finished, YARN Scheduler was under a monolithic lock. Global scheduling introduced in this Jira improved the internal locking structure and the thread model, so the scheduler can now decouple placement decisions and can look up multiple nodes at a time. YARN also has now multiple allocation threads. These improvements can mean up to 5 to 10 times throughput as before. Another reason could be node partitioning and node labeling. Labels can be seen basically as partitions of the cluster. Labels can be defined as shared or exclusive and created, and the node can only have one single label at a time. Common use of the labels is for example, targeting special hardware in the cluster, like GPU, or deploy license software against a specific subset of the cluster. Shared labels, as the name suggests, allow applications in other labeled partitions to grow into them if no application is asking for that label, but they will be preempted when some new app requests it. Exclusive labels are only accessible to the applications that specifically target them. Affinity and anti-affinity is basically, affinity is basically to run X and Y applications on the same nodes. This is good, for example, for the data locality. Anti-affinity is the opposite. Never run an X and Y application on the same nodes. You can use this when both of the applications are using excessively the same resources on that node. So let's see what this tool is about exactly. As you could see, Fair Scheduler and Capacity Scheduler has different approach to sharing resources on a cluster, but Capacity Scheduler can support the basic behavior of Fair Scheduler. However, it is the more sophisticated features will work on very different principles. So even after using this tool, it will be fine-tuning will be needed. This tool was created to help the migration as much as possible by generating the correct configuration entries or even the combination of multiple configuration entries based on the existing Fair Scheduler settings. fs2cs is a command line application which can be invoked by using the YARN fs2cs command and adding various command line arguments to it. The tool expects YARN site XML and Fair Scheduler XML allocations file as input and generates the delta YARN site XML and capacity scheduler configuration files as output. The delta YARN site XML only contains the capacity scheduler specific settings, so manual copy paste is required to the existing or in use YARN site XML file as part of the migration. This means that the Fair Scheduler specific settings will be left in place after the migration. The users don't necessarily need to remove them, as it is unlikely that they will cause any harm, but to avoid confusion, they should be. The tool's internal workflow is the following. After some basic validation steps, like do the input files and the output directory exists, it loads the YARN site XML and converts the global scheduling-related properties or common scheduling-related properties, like preemption and continuous scheduling. Then it spins up a Fair Scheduler instance to parse the allocations file, Fair Scheduler XML. It walks through the queue hierarchy and converts the supported properties to Hadoop configuration objects, and it displays a warning message on each unsupported property. Once the conversion is done, it writes out the generated XMLs and starts a capacity scheduler instance to check the new configuration and check if the whether the resource manager is able to start up with this new configuration. To look at some of the features of this tool, let's take a look at the actual CLI options. The dash Y option is necessary as it tells the tool that where the YARN site XML is. It is this first one. The options in brackets show the optional flags, and the option in curly braces shows the mandatory options to choose from. So either the user has to determine what the output directory is where the output files will be written, or the user can choose to tell the tool that it should print out the configuration files to the console. A few notable parameters are the following. Next to dash help or dash help or dash h prints out the available flags. Dash d performs a dry run, which outputs whether the conversion is possible or not. Dash s skips the validation. If this is specified, then the tool won't start the capacity scheduler instance to validate the converted configuration. And dash t is a compatibility option, or it can be seen as a force option. Before YARN 8967, that was a refactoring Fair Scheduler, you could have some specific rule setups in Fair Scheduler where some of the rules weren't actually reachable. This doesn't necessarily cause a problem because they aren't reachable, but the new Fair Scheduler implementations throw an exception because of this. This dash T is to force this option through and to suppress this exception. So let's see a basic example. What does happen during the conversion with a queue setup? And what happens with the weights. As I explained, the first scheduler part of the talk, weights are used to determine the fair share of resources of a queue in the long run. This concept is quite similar to the capacities in capacity scheduler. However, if the queue, for example, has the capacity of, for example, 25%, then it can only use the 25% of parent's queue's resources. This is not exactly what we have seen in fair scheduler, because fair scheduler also allows elasticity. So if a queue is not using all its resources, other queues can use it. For this, in capacity scheduler, we have to enable the elasticity by defining the max capacity to every single queue with the value of 100%. Additionally, without any specific settings, the default configuration differences are handled. For example, the maximum application master share by default in fair scheduler is 0.5 and 0.1 in capacity scheduler. This is quite an important setting because it tells the scheduler that the maximum fraction or percent of the cluster's resources that can be used by application master. So it's basically a way to limit the running applications. During conversion, this is automatically set to 0.5 in capacity scheduler. On the left side, you can see the original queue setup in the fair scheduler queue setup. On the right side, you can see the new capacity scheduler queue setup. Some of the supported features are on this slide. On the left side, you can see the common or global settings. On the right side, you can see the queue-related settings. I won't go through every single one of them because of time constraints. It's very important to mention that this tool is not a magic tool. There are limitations mainly caused by the inner working differences between the two schedulers. One of the main limitations is the placement rules conversion. As I've mentioned before, capacity scheduler has two types of parent queues, managed parents and non-managed parents. A managed parent can only have dynamically created queues, while non-managed parents can only have static queues defined in capacityscheduler.xml. In contrast to this, fair scheduler allows to mix and match statically and dynamically created queues under the same parent by using the create flag in the placement rules. At any rule can have the create flag. This sometimes makes it impossible to automatically convert placement rules, so the cluster administrator has to do it manually. To mitigate this, a lot of the placement related differences are being handled in a new placement engine that is under development. It will create a new, more flexible JSON placement rule format. However, this create flag will still be limited as it is too deeply integrated into YARN. Another limitation caused by this is the fair scheduler's allow underclass rules configuration entry. If this entry is true, then placement engine creates a new queue during application submission based on the submitter's request. Or if the user has default property is true, then based on the submitter's username. Capacity scheduler has something similar under auto-create child queue, but it requires the parent to be managed, so it can't have any statically created queues. The min and max resources and max child resources are simply more flexible in fair scheduler. In capacity scheduler, capacity and max capacity could be similar, but either everything is absolute or everything is relative. In fair scheduler, these can be mixed, and separate limits can be provided for memory and CPU, even in relative mode, which is currently not possible in capacity scheduler. So let's see a quick demo about the tool and how does it work. I have prepared the basic YARN site XML and fair scheduler XML. Let's see the YARN site XML. It only contains the fair scheduler related properties. For example, let's modify it to have the more basic settings, like preemption turned off and continue scheduling also turned off. let's invoke the fs2cs command with the help. So it tells us what kind of options are available. And let's use the YARN site demo that I mentioned. Absolute path is needed. Let's give it the basic fair scheduler XML allocations file. And let's print the results into the console. So as I've mentioned, we didn't use the dash T option, the skip the no terminal rule check option. And it tells us that there are rules which are unreachable. To solve this, I can simply force the action. And as you can see, here are the capacity scheduler XML, there are the queue properties, and there are the basic default option, the maximum AM resource percent set to 0.5. And the YARN site XML contains only very basic settings. For example, the resource calculator is dominant resource calculator, and the capacity scheduler should be the scheduler class. Let's modify YARN site demo XML again and use set preemption to true. And let's set continuous settings to true as well. I run this again. You can see there is a warning that here is a warning that some setting is not supported. And now the YARN site XML part contains a bit more information. Asynchronous scheduling related properties, the interval and the enable is enabled because continuous scheduling was enabled in fair scheduler. And the preemption related settings like monitoring enabled is enabled as well. So that's about it. Here are some references if you want to delve deeper in this. And thank you. Do you have any questions? So the first question is, do we need to restart the RM or dynamically upload it? If you change the settings, you need to restart the resource manager. FS2CS2, you have to manually migrate the settings, so it doesn't do it for you. Yeah, the next section is about YARN capacity scheduler and CD related questions. I only talked about the upstream related things. The downstream related things are not my table, sorry. This tool is basically to help the migration from fair scheduler to capacity scheduler. Yeah, the next question is why Cloud Data's official documentation advises to migrate away from capacity scheduler. I mainly took part in the upstream development, so I really can't answer that. So if no other questions, thank you for your attention. I hope you, oh, sorry, Q-related. Yes, you do need to configure it manually. The question was only Q-related will be changed, right? Capacity can have additional features like node label, which we need to configure manually. Yes, you need to configure it manually. As far as I know, fs2cs doesn't support these new features. It's the suggestion is to manually check the configuration because as both of the schedulers are working very differently, you will need to check and even fine tune the converted configuration. So, if no other questions, then thank you for your attention. I hope I could make your time worthwhile, and bye-bye. Oh, sorry, sure. Yes, this tool is basically converts the configuration and creates an output file for you, but you will need to manually place this input file and restart the resource manager. This won't be uploaded manually, automatically. Okay, then let's wait for a few more seconds. Okay, so thank you very much again. Bye.